everyone. I'm back for another Rewind. Since I missed last month, I'm going to be doing double duty and trying to recap some of the biggest power platform announcements for the month of June and July. We got a ton to cover, so let's get started. So I was debating how to best kick off this episode of Rewind, and I figured we have to start with the news about Power Apps licensing. This news made me very happy, and I'm sure a lot of you all as well. Effective on October 1st of this year, we're going to have brand new licensing for Power Apps. The first major change is to the per-user plan. This plan has been $40 a user a month for an unlimited amount of Power Apps applications. Now, there's been quite a few changes to licensing, and you might have noticed that as of late, there's been a few promotional licenses available out there that are slightly cheaper. So what they did is they lowered that per-user license to only $20 a month, so they cut the price in half. So now you pay $20 per user per month, and that user that's licensed up can use as many Power Apps as their heart desires. The other change is a little less straightforward. So we've had the per user license, but then there was also the per app license for Power Apps. The per app license name was always a little strange. And that's because you didn't simply get one application per user per license. You actually were able to license up two Power Apps and a portal with that license. And that pricing was $10 per app or two applications and a portal per user per month. So while we don't really save anything with this change, it just clarifies the name of the license and its intent. So effective again, October 1st, we're going to have the per app license be $5 per user per app per month. And that is just a single application. So no more what does per app mean, being is it two apps and a portal, it's just one application, whether it's Power App, Canvas app, using premium features or a model-driven app, per user per month. So if you're using any of that promo licensing going on now, that is extended, and you can keep using that until the new pricing takes effect on October 1st. Microsoft also announced the general availability of the Power Apps component framework for Canvas apps. We've had the Power Apps component framework in general availability for model-driven apps for a while now, so this is a pretty big milestone to have this available in both model-driven and Canvas apps now. For those of you who might not know what PCF is, it stands for Power Apps Component Framework. It's a way for code-first developers to create custom controls for Power Apps applications. Super excited to finally see this in general availability. Speaking of PCF, one of the other announcements along with the general availability of that for Canvas apps is ALM support. When we use these PCF controls in our Power Apps Canvas apps, they're called code components. Now, if you have one of these code components inside of a Canvas app that's inside a solution, we can track that and handle that and see if there's any dependencies with any code components that you might have. Sticking on the Power Apps train of news, if you built a Canvas app recently, you might have noticed that the settings look a bit different. We have a new look and feel for the settings menu that is very user-friendly. I love the way that they've organized the upcoming feature section. Now we can easily see what's preview, experimental, or retired functionality. And another new thing that you might have noticed they added is the support tab. If you've ever run into an issue with the Canvas app that you're building, the support tab is your friend. It gives you all the information you need to know to give to the people that help you debug it, like the environment, the authoring version, session ID, and session details. Back in the May Power Platform Rewind show, you might have remembered that I mentioned a new Visual Studio Code extension for the Power Platform. Well, that is available, and they've even added the ability to manage your Canvas app source code directly in the VS Code extension. I wanted to clarify the difference between this VS Code extension and the Power Platform CLI, because this question came up quite a bit, and really, there is no difference. Everything that we can do in the Power Platform CLI, we can do in the VS Code extension. Now, to me, the VS Code extension has some pretty big benefits over using the CLI, namely that it has automatic updates, and since it's VS Code, it works both on Windows and a Mac. So any of my fellow Mac users out there, we can finally work with the Power Apps CLI thanks to this new VS Code extension. So if you haven't already, go download it today. Another thing that you heard me talk about back in May was independent publishers. This was announced in May at Build, but it wasn't quite released yet. Well, now fast forward to the end of July here, and we can build and use our own independent publisher connectors in Power Automate. And with that announcement that these independent publisher connectors are live, we have a few new connectors that were released as part of the independent publisher connector program. And one of those, as you're seeing here, is Airtable. And if you didn't catch the May episode of Power Platform Rewind and you're wondering what these independent publisher connectors are, well, they're just custom connectors that are developed and supported by community members. So it's independent from the end service or the API. So any community member like myself and you all watching can go out and create a custom connector to any service that doesn't currently have one, add that to the independent publisher GitHub repo, and eventually have that show up inside of the Power Automate experience. So that's really what the big goal of the independent publisher connector program is, to give us an opportunity to publish a connector and have it show up in the official list of Microsoft connectors. So go to that link there and check it out. And if you have any cool connectors, share them with the community. All right, let's talk more Power Apps, specifically the model-driven app side of things. Super excited to see the release of custom pages in preview inside of our model-driven apps. This is a big leap in what they're calling the convergence of model-driven and Canvas application development. So right now, we want to create a Canvas app so that we have full control over the look and feel and all of that. And then we create a model-driven app if we want to take more of a data-driven approach. Well, the end goal here is to create a more converged or unified experience for creating these applications. And these pages inside of model-driven apps are the first step towards that. So as you're seeing here, inside of a model-driven app, you can add a new page. We can use these in the main area, dialogues, and the new app side pane. So what this means is we can put a Canvas application inside of a model-driven app, which is what you're seeing here. So many great possibilities of this. And one of the things that kind of goes along with this announcement, which this is currently in preview right now, is the PowerFX Command Designer preview. So we have this concept of commands in our model-driven applications. Well, to build those in the past, we needed to know some traditional code, like JavaScript, for example. Not anymore. With this new feature that's part of the Converge experience and is in preview right now, called Commanding, we can create our own custom commands in model-driven applications and create those using PowerFX, the formula language that we're already used to using in Canvas apps. And if you want to know more about this new pages experience and the ability to create these new custom buttons or commands, as they're called, inside of model-driven apps, then definitely check out community member Daniel Laskowitz's video. He just did a video, I believe the other day or the day before, talking through and walking through these new features, and it's a really great introduction to both. And I'll put a link to that in the video notes. We talked a lot about Power Apps so far. Let's talk about Power Automate Desktop. There were a few really cool updates to Power Automate Desktop in the month of June and July. One of the ones that really stood out to me is the ability to run a desktop flow from another desktop flow. This is a common approach we've taken in our cloud flows for a while now with something called child flows. So there's a new run desktop flow action inside of Power Automate Desktop. And why exactly would you want to use this? Well, it allows us to break down some of our more larger, complicated processes into smaller, more autonomous ones so that we're able to better manage and troubleshoot those. Some other key updates are the ability to delete unused UI elements in your UI flows, the new take screenshot action, and the ability to do silent registration for machines. Another news item that I wanted to make sure to point out that didn't get a ton of press, unlike some of the other ones that I've covered so far, is the ability to rename action-based data sources inside of our Canvas applications. Let's break down what this means exactly. So first of all, what is an action-based data source? Well, this is something other than our traditional tabular data sources like SharePoint and Excel, where we would physically store and retrieve data. So action-based data sources would be things like Azure DevOps, Office 365 users, and Outlook. And you might be thinking, big deal, we can rename these data sources. What does that actually mean? Well, the big benefit is to be able to fix broken formula references. So when I saw this, that's where my mind instantly went. So take this scenario. You see a cool community template, maybe one of the ones I built, like the desk reservation template, and you want to import that template into your environment. And maybe this particular template uses Office 365 users to get the current user information. If for any reason that data connection name doesn't match with the formulas that you have inside of your app, that's going to cause a ton of errors in your application that you have to hunt down and try to fix. But now, thanks to this rename functionality, if that happens, all we have to do is go to that action-based connector, rename it to whatever it's supposed to be to match our formulas, and we're good to go. Next up on the list is also related to Power Apps Canvas apps, and that's the ability to read NFC tags. NFC stands for Near Field Communication. They're just these little physical tags like you're seeing here that you can put on different objects and be able to track those with kind of Bluetooth-like near field communication. So rather than, say, maybe scanning a barcode that can get dusty and dirty and hard to read, you scan this little electronic tag, NFC tag, instead, and it can store information about the object. It's used a lot in inventory situations. So this is just one more tool in our tool belt with Power Apps Canvas apps to be able to handle these type of inventory situations by not only being able to read barcodes, but now these NFC tags. And if you want to learn more about how NFC tags work, I don't have a video on that quite yet, but the infamous Shane's Cow, Shane Young, does, so go check out his channel and his video on how these NFC tags work. All right, well, I think I've covered all the major announcements for June and July for the Power Platform. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll catch you next month for the next Power Platform Rewind.